Okay, we can start now.
Okay, thank you very much. So I'd like to welcome everyone to this plenary session, the first one at the ECSS conference this year. And we have the luck that we have Peter Magnusson and Jes Snedeker to present for us today with a common title, Tendon Adaptation to Mechanical Loading in Sports, Health and Disease. My name is Pierre Egard, and I'm supposed to be chairing this session. I'm from the University of Southern Denmark, and I have co-chairs.
Ein bisschen leiser, weil ich hab's doppelt und zwar 30 Sekunden verzögert.
I think we need some unmuting somewhere here. Well, anyways, co-chairs with me today will be Jan Kabri from the Luxembourg University of Research in Orthopedics and Sports Medicine, and also Professor Jan Wulff-Helge from University of Copenhagen. So the way we're going to do this session is to have Peter Magnusson presenting first, followed by Jes Snedeker afterwards, and then by the end of the two talks, we will be able to have 15 or maybe 20 minutes of questions and discussion going on. So I'd like to start with introducing Peter Magnusson, which will have the presenter title of The Impact of Loading and Unloading on Healthy and Injured Human Tendon. But before Peter starts, I'd like just briefly to mention that he works at the Institute of Sports Medicine in Copenhagen at Bispebjerg Hospital, University of Copenhagen. And he earned his Master of Science in Physical Therapy from the University of Louisville in Kentucky, USA, and had his Doctor of Medical Science degree at the University of Copenhagen some years ago. A large focus on the research of Peter Magnusson have been to gain insight into the structure and function of human tendons as it relates to force transmission and strain behavior, not only at the macroscopic, but also at the nanoscale levels. And in addition, extensive research activities have been conducted to look at the changes in tendon tissue function, that could be stiffness morphology, which we'll hear about, and also changes in cellular and molecular tissue composition in response to changes in physical activity and inactivity, and also with injury and rehabilitation, as you will notice. So, in other words, the response of tendon tissues to various forms of treatment of tendon injury has been extensively examined by Peter Magnusson and the co-workers in his lab. Thus, it's a great pleasure for me to welcome Peter Magnusson to give his opening lecture at this year's ECSS meeting. Please, Peter.
Okay, let's see, are we on here? I guess we are. Thank you for the kind introduction, Per, and I'd like to thank the organizers for letting me share some of the thoughts that we've thoughts and data that we've had on this topic over the last 20 years or so. I imagine that it's an extremely difficult task to organize a big conference like this, and I also imagine that it's been even harder under the pandemic situation that we have here. So I'm going to talk to you about the impact of loading and unloading in healthy and injured human tendon. And let's see here. It doesn't work so well. Okay. Let me just do a little technical thing here. So we're going to be talking about collagen to a large extent, and collagen is one of the most abundant molecules in the animal kingdom, including in human mankind. The collagen molecules aggregate into fibrils, and these collagen molecules are bound by cross links. And it's important to realize that the fibril is the basic building block that provides some of this tissue integrity and strength in tissues. And depending on how it's organized in a tissue, it can be a very stiff force transmitting unit, such as in the bone, or it can be more a compliant tissue or less stiff tissue, such as in the skin. And the same thing goes for the tendon. It's built up aggregated in the same way. So we have the molecules. The molecules form these fibrils that are the basic load-bearing tissue in tendon. And these collagen molecules are primarily type 1. There are some other types of collagen as well, but we're going to be focusing on the type 1 primarily. And here on the right-hand side, you see an atomic force microscopy image of a single fibril at the nanoscale level. A lot of these fibrils are aggregated into fascicles. And then, of course, you have the whole tendon that you can see here on the MRI. In between these fibrils, you also have the other components of the extracellular matrix, which is in part proteoglycans and glycosaminoglycans that serve to hydrate the tissue, but are also involved in fibrillogenesis. For a long time, it's been discussed whether or not these fibrils that you can see here are continuous or discontinuous when you look at the whole tendon. And we've just shown that it looks like the fibrils are actually continuous. That means that they run from one end of the tendon to the other end of the tendon. And if you isolate one of these fibrils at the nanoscale level, which we've been able to do and test them, then what you can see is that the individual fibrils behave a little bit like the whole tendon would behave. Namely, that if you mechanically test it at different speeds, the faster you test it, the stiffer it will be. On the unloading part here, if we follow the red line, there's loss of energy, so there's some hysteresis. So in many ways, these collagen fibrils behave similar to how you would expect the whole tendon to behave. But of course, there are also cells in the tendon, and they are interspersed between the fibrils. They are about 1 to 3% of the total mass. And I just want to point out here from a study on horse that the DNA as a surrogate of cell content does not really seem to diminish over age, which means that the ability, at least from the cell perspective, to adapt and perhaps repair injury over time does not seem to actually decline with age. So the question then becomes, how do cells respond to loading? Okay, so there are many ways that you can look at this, and you can, for example, put cells on a surface and then stretch the surface and then measure different things that the cell may produce. So you can, for example, look at growth factors. This is TGF-beta. And what you can see is when you stretch the cell, there are some response in terms of the growth factor release. You could also look at the gene expression of collagen, and that also increases with stretching, as well as the actual collagen production. So the collagen production goes up when you stretch it a little bit, and it goes up a little bit more when you stretch it a little bit more. This implies that there's some sort of relationship between the amount of collagen type 1 production and the amount of strain on the cell. Okay, so that was on the cell level. The question is, does that translate to the human? And so there are different ways of looking at this. And one of the first experiments we did, we simply said, well, is there metabolic activity in the tendon if you use the muscle that attaches to that very tendon? So what we did was we infused a glucose tracer, and we allowed these people to work hard with one side, whereas the other side was the control leg. And then we used a PET scan to see if there was glucose uptake. And I want you to focus here on the bottom of the image here. Here's the MRI image, and this is the Achilles tendon. Here is the Achilles tendon of the side that worked, and you can see there is actually glucose uptake here, whereas there is none on the control side. So this tells us that the tendon tissue is metabolically active, okay? And I should point out also that this was at very low contraction forces. Now, the question becomes, of course, metabolic activity, that doesn't really necessarily directly relate to collagen production. So you have to go about trying to examine that question in a different way. So one way to do this is to use the stable isotope technique, where people work for some time and then you take a biopsy to see if you can measure the fractional synthesis rate, which is the synthesis rate of the actual collagen in the tendon. And what you can see here in this experiment after 1 hour of hard work was that 24 hours after that work, there was collagen synthesis that was on the order of about 1% per day. And if you try to calculate the collagen half-life based on that, that would mean that the collagen half-life would be about 2 months. That's almost on the order of muscle, which we know is very metabolically active and has a high turnover. Another way to look at this is on the right-hand side here, where they've looked at aspartic acid racemization, and this is a different technique, and they've used a horse tendon. And bottom line is when they calculate the collagen half-life, it turns out to be close to 200 years. So it's safe to say that there's some discrepancy here. So how can we see if we can find out what the truth is here? So a different way of doing this is looking at what's called the bump pulse technique. Now, carbon 14 is something that's sort of in the atmosphere at extremely low concentrations. But during the 50s, there was a number of nuclear bomb tests that increased the carbon 14 level in the atmosphere. And that can be used to measure the carbon 14 uptake in tissue. So what we did was we took a number of cadaver tendons, and we took the core of the Achilles tendon. I'm gonna see if I can, yeah, I can't do that. I can't see that upper corner, but there's the core of the Achilles tendon. And we also took some muscle tissue. Now, if a tissue has a high turnover, it will have basically the amount of carbon 14 concentration as in the atmosphere. And what you can see here are these red dots. These are the carbon 14 concentration in muscle, which corresponds to the time of death. So these are highly, there's a high turnover in this tissue. That's not so surprising. All these dots here are the carbon 14 concentration of the Achilles tendon. And when we took an average, a moving average of 17 years of the carbon 14 concentration, we could see that the carbon 14 concentration of the tendons were on this same line here as the average of the 17 years of carbon 14 concentration. So it looked like the tendon was formed during the growth and essentially was not renewed after that. Okay. So at that time, we thought that maybe, well, the tendon grows like a tree, it has rings on the trees. These were the early part. And then, of course, the later parts come in later. And we've looked at the tendon just recently of pigs. And when we test the fascicles of the core versus periphery, we can actually see that the core is stronger than the periphery. So there's maybe some related to that concept, but when we look at the fluorescence, which is a surrogate of turnover, it looks like the core and the periphery has the same turnover. So it gets to be a little complicated. But what we did was we looked then at cadaver tissue again with the carbon 14 technique, and looked at different portions of the tendon. And these five circles here correspond to five different people And what you can see is that the data points here of carbon-14 concentration from different parts of the tendon in a single individual is basically on top of one another, indicating then that the tendon was formed at the same time. So what to make of all this? Well, we're not really sure, but we're suggesting that this tree concept for the whole tendon probably goes out the window. And it may be, and I need to preface that we don't really know, but it may be then that a large percentage of collagen in a tendon is relatively stable after growth, maybe even as much as 95%. And 5% is maybe used for repair and homeostasis. So you could think of these individual fibrils as individual trees within the forest. So the question then becomes, can tendons adapt and grow in response to loading? Now, in the previous slide, I forgot to say that this also implies, if this is correct, that the ability to adapt and grow is relatively small compared to maybe some other tissues, and possibly also something that takes a long time. So if a tendon can hypertrophy, just like a muscle, right, then for an average force, you would have a reduced average stress across that tendon. So can it hypertrophy? So some of our earlier experiments, we simply measured the cross-sectional area of the Achilles tendon in runners and non-runners. And what you can see is that the runners had a greater cross-sectional area and that this was greater towards the distal region versus the more proximal region. We also looked at different athletes that load their tendons in different ways. So for example, again, the runners versus somebody who sits at a kayak or in a kayak and does not really load the tendon a lot, and you can see that the person who loads or the group that loads their tendon have a larger tendon, implying then that maybe the load plays a role. The problem with all that stuff is, of course, that these are cross-sectional studies. So we said, okay, well, let's have some people run for 9 months. So they ran and they improved in all sorts of cardiovascular parameters, so they did the work. But when we looked at this cross-section of the Achilles tendon, there was absolutely no change. And this was over a nine-month period. So then we said, well, maybe there's a different kind of load that's needed for the tendon to respond. So we did some heavy resistance training. And what you could see is that the tendon increased about 4 to 6% and did so in the different insertion points, namely mostly distal and most proximal, but not so much in the middle. These studies are flawed or have limitations. There's training history, selection bias, inter-subject variation, and relatively short durations of training when you think about how slow the turnover of tendon tissue is. So we said, well, let's look at people that have trained one side differently than the other side for years. And that could be fencers or badminton players. And when we looked at this group of people, we can see that the tendon is a lot larger. This is the patellar tendon now, again, primarily at the insertion sites compared to the other side that doesn't train as much. Importantly, when we test the mechanical properties, we can see that the most loaded side is actually stiffer than the contralateral side. And when we look at the stress strain or the modulus, there's no difference. So it looks like, you know, there's something is happening when people load for a long time on one side versus the other. We have just recently revisited this concept. And these are unpublished data so far, so take it with a grain of salt. But if we focus on young men here, again, badminton players, you can see that on the side where they load more, that's what we call the lead side, they have a tendon that's about 17% larger than on the other side. And again, the stiffness follows that same pattern, so they are stiffer on the more loaded side. We also took tendon biopsies and can see that the fibril density was greater on that side that they're loading. So it looks like there's also something going on the morphological level. So now I quickly want to jump into tendinopathy, and we don't have a lot of time to discuss the details of what tendinopathy is. Suffice it to say that this is where you have some neovessels, some increased cellularity, there's swelling and pain, and people aren't very happy. This is quite a prevalent problem in a number of different sports, for example, and primarily maybe in volleyball or jumping sports like volleyball and basketball. So the question is, how should we treat these? And I think at this point, most people would agree that some sort of loading-based rehab is what's considered the gold standard today. Now, there's a lot of discussion about the different muscle contraction modes that one should use. And I just want to comment on it quickly. So for example, in this high impact journal in 1679, it was shown that basically the tendon will respond to the magnitude of load, okay? And therefore you can almost assume that this is unrelated to the muscle contraction mode. In a more recent article, a couple of hundred years or so, or 400 or 300 years, you can see in this biomechanical study where they've tried to measure the amount of elongation of the Achilles tendon during a heel rise. You can see that on the way up and on the way down, the amount of deformation is the same. So this would imply then that muscle contraction mode is maybe not so important, but more the force is what's important. Let's look at the basic science of what this tells us. And if we look at the collagen 1 gene expression at a similar load, it makes no difference if the constant, if the muscle contraction is concentric, eccentric, or isometric. And in studies, and there's really only one that I can think of where they've looked at this a little bit more in detail, the amount of hypertrophy of the tendon is similar, whether it's eccentric or concentric contraction. So how should we treat them? Well, it probably doesn't matter so much with the muscle contraction type. And this was something that was done many, many years ago, where we didn't try to control for the magnitude of load, but we basically said, well, what happens if you, at that point, this was still quite popular, where I'm from, were namely corticosteroid injection, and how does that compare to, for example, the eccentric contraction, which I think a lot of you are familiar with, versus something maybe slightly new at that point or at that time, which was heavy, slow resistance. So it's important to know that eccentric contraction is something that's typically done twice a day and with a lighter load than, for example, heavy, slow resistance training, which is done only 3 times a week and at a much higher load. What you can see here is basically that corticosteroid injection, well, they all improved after 12 weeks, but the corticosteroid injection, which you have here, did not do as well as the contraction modes in terms of the VSAP, which is a PROM. The important thing here to note is that the blue bar here represents basically what's left until you reach 100%. And it's important to note that even after the intervention was for 12 weeks, but even at the 6-month follow-up, these people aren't back to normal, okay? We were also able to take tendon biopsies, and I'm not gonna spend a lot of time on it. Suffice it to say that the heavy, slow resistance training group had a more favorable profile in terms of the collagen and some of these cross links that I haven't mentioned a whole lot. So we thought maybe it's special with the patellar tendon. So we repeated this in the Achilles tendon and we basically saw the same thing. Namely, if you do this program, which is twice a day with a slightly lighter load, or if you do this heavier load 3 times a week, both groups got better, but again, and the treatment intervention period was for 12 weeks, but again, 52 weeks. So now we're talking a year later, they're still not back to, I guess, baseline level in terms of the pain during heel rise, or the SIA, which is the PROM. So this brings us to the whole notion of does magnitude load play a role? I'm going to speed up here because I'm looking at my watch and I'm thinking I have maybe 10 more minutes. So now I'm going to go back to a study that was done on healthy subjects to kind of give us an idea of what we could possibly expect. And this is a study that was done a little while back. This was a 14-week training study. The contractions were isometric. That's perhaps not so important right now. And it was 3 seconds loading and 3 seconds of unloading. The important thing is that the two groups were divided into a high load, so 90% of MVC and 55% of MVC. And the bottom line here is that the people in the group that performed the high load, they could see some tendon hypertrophy, where and when they measured the stiffness or compliance, they could see that the people that performed the high load, they were actually stiffer. So something happened on the stiffness and something happened in terms of the growth. And these things could not be detected at the low force training group. So that gives us a hint that maybe load is important. And this is exactly what I started out by saying. So we have just completed a study where we try to do this, not in healthy subjects, but in people with tendinopathy. So in this case, it's patellar tendinopathy. And what we've tried to do is put people in two groups, heavy slow resistance training or the more medium resistance training. So it's again, 55% MVC and 90% MVC. And we're trying to adjust the repetitions so that the load is approximately the same. Over the course of the 12-week period, both groups improve in strength, okay, which is what you would expect. When we look at the PROM or the VSAP, over the intervention period, there's an improvement, so they feel better, but there's no difference between the two groups, okay? When we do the follow-up 1 year later, again, they continue to improve a little bit. Of course, we're not entirely sure what they've done in this period. Nevertheless, they improve, but there is no difference between those two groups. And again, it takes a long time for them to become completely pain-free. When we look at the force deformation or the stiffness before and after the 12-week period, we see no change. There's no change in either group, before and after, or between the groups. So now I want to get to something that a lot of people talk about, and that is, well, what happens with stiffness of a tendon when it becomes injured or sick, like in the case of a chronic tendinopathy? And in this case, we're talking about patellar tendinopathy. People have looked at this by comparing injured groups versus uninjured groups. This is possibly problematic. Here's an early study that we did in our lab, and it's just the force deformation curve in two individuals. And you can see that the force deformation curve is vastly different and the stiffness is vastly different. So there are huge differences between individuals, which is something to keep in mind. So an alternative way is to look at people with unilateral symptoms. Now, I know that some people would argue that somebody with a unilateral injury is somebody who is about to get something on the other side, and that may be, but I think this may be a slightly better way to look at it. And here are some data, recent data from our lab, where we look at the ultrasound thickness, and here's the injured tendon. So they are wider versus the uninjured tendon. This is a common way also of quantifying the amount of involvement in the tendon that you see up here. And you can also look at the neovascularization with power Doppler, and you can see a huge difference. Now, if we compare the mechanical properties of these two tendons, we can see that there is absolutely no difference. And this would imply then that the injury itself doesn't really affect the mechanical properties of the tendon, or alternatively, it would mean that any injury or influence on the mechanical properties is so small that we can't detect it with this particular technique. That was chronic tendinopathy. I'm going to skip this just to say that if we look at people with acute or subacute patellar tendinopathy, the stiffness between the injured and the uninjured leg is also the same. So the difference, or the lack of difference rather, is similar whether it's acute or chronic. Now, very quickly, I just want to say that, you know, we can also learn about the healing ability in an injured tendon from the Achilles tendon rupture model, if you will. So here again is a PET scanning with the glucose tracer in an injured or a ruptured Achilles tendon 3 months after a surgical repair, versus on the control healthy side. And you can see clearly that the metabolic activity is far, far greater on the injured side. It's maybe not so surprising that you would see this at 3 months, but it's still the same, almost the same at 6 months. And when we do the data analysis at 12 months, which you see over here, it turns out that it's not entirely back to normal. So this is just to say that an injured tendon takes a long time to heal. We could also look at tendon strain at a given force as a proxy of stiffness. And you can see over the 52 weeks that we follow these people with an Achilles tendon rupture, it continues to get stiffer and stiffer. So it takes on the order of maybe a year for a tendon or an injured tendon to heal. Now I'm going to rush through the unloading and inactivity part. And what happens to a tendon when it becomes unloaded? Well, again, you know, we can go to cell studies, okay? And we can look at, for example, the cell death that happens when a tendon is unloaded. And it turns out that there's a lot of cell death or apoptosis if you unload a tendon, but if you keep it, if you keep strain on the tendon over a 24-hour cycle, you can reduce that cell death a little bit. Here's a study from our lab where we've looked at unloading a tendon construct that we've developed. And you can see that the RNA expression for collagen 1 drastically declines if you remove the tension. And the bottom line is, at the cellular level, unloading tendon tissue has dramatic effects. So what about at the whole tendon level? You can do this in different ways. So you can do this, for example, and take a model like spinal cord injured people, and this is not from our lab or from Megan Harris and co-workers, and they've compared able-bodied people with spinal cord people, and they can look at the stress strain and see that it's vastly, vastly different. Now this, of course, is on a year scale. So what about if we go to the month scale? Well, people have shown that you can actually reduce the stiffness if you put people under microgravity, which is some form of unloading, if you will. So even at months, you can see something happening with the tendon. Now, what is happening? Well, you can look at the tendon synthesis rate. And in this study, they show that the tendon synthesis rate is declined or reduced already after 2 weeks or 10 days, and it continues to decline. And it appears that the stiffness is also declining over that same relatively short period of time. Here's a study from our lab where we look at the fractional synthesis rate. And with 2 weeks of immobilization, you can see that there is a drastic reduction in the fractional synthesis rate of collagen. And so this is just to say that in contrast a little bit to some of the changes that we see with loading, which seem to take a relatively long time, when you unload a tendon, the changes you can measure are fairly quick. And I just want to finish off with this then, because this is a study from our own lab where we can see that the stiffness is reduced already after 2 weeks of immobilization, the same thing as I told you before. And the interesting thing is, when we look at the cross-sectional area of the tendon, it does not seem to change. So on one hand, you have a decline in synthesis rate, but in terms of the amount of tissue that you can detect on an MRI, at least, it doesn't seem to change a lot. It may be that the quality changes, we're not sure. And with that, I thank you for your attention. And I think that was 35 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Peter. Thank you very much, Peter, for this interesting talk. And we keep our questions and discussion points till after Jess has presented. Let's see, you know, I might be able to show this now. Is this visible for you? I'm not sure whether I'm sharing this or not. Maybe I should do like this to make sure. Okay. But yes. I'm not sure whether this is visible for you, Peter, and yes?
Yeah, I can see it, yeah.
Yeah, I can see Peter again.
Okay, and I think we're gonna jump from Peter. Thank you, yes, for correcting me. Yeah, it's a pleasure for me to welcome Jess, of course. Snedeker, you are affiliated at the Department of Orthopedics, which is located at the Faculty of Medicine at the University of Zurich in Swiss. And you're also affiliated to the Institute of Biomechanics at the Swiss Center for Musculoskeletal Research, also in Zurich. Professor Snedeker, he earned his Master of Science in Bioengineering from the Penn State University, and later on a PhD in Biomedical Engineering from the ETH Institute in Zurich, where you're working right now, I think, same place. You have published a large number of scientific high-impact papers with a highly innovative experimental focus on the mechanobiology and attendant disease mechanisms, and also with an increased focus on regeneration medicine, I think, in terms of tendon tissue. And I think the data that we can read about in your papers, they have a really important meaning for the ability to deepen our understanding in the adaptive plasticity of tendon tissue in response to exercise-based rehabilitation. And also, I think you have your data have enormous implication for the prevention of tendinopathy in sports, not only sports, I guess, but also working life and even aging and within activity types of disease. And besides of all the basic research, Snedeker and his research group also have actively developed and tried to clinically translate next generation orthopedic devices to improve the patient outcome for various patient groups and improve quality of life. So you are covering a really broad spectrum of nice aspects related to tendon tissue dynamics. So it's a great pleasure for me to welcome Snedeker to give this opening lecture, which is entitled Mechanisms of Human Tendon Plasticity, Links from Molecules to Cells to Athletes to Patients. Really funky title. Thank you.
All right. So thank you very much, Per, for the really nice introduction. I wasn't sure you were talking about me there, actually. But
I am.
It was so nice. And I also want to congratulate Peter on a great talk. So I couldn't have asked for a better talk. And I have to say it's really an honor to be able to present next to Peter. You know, I when I was a PhD student and postdoc, I was reading his papers and also your papers, Per, and I still feel a little bit young. I still feel a little bit young at heart, but it's really a surreal experience to be able to present in this context. So thanks a lot. So we just heard very beautifully from Peter that tendons adapt to mechanical loads, and of course a lot of what we know here we can thank the Danish for that. We saw a lot of the in vivo data on humans was focusing a lot on increased cross-sectional area. And Peter talked nicely to peritendinous collagen synthesis, whether that's where it happens or not, or whether it happens in the core, or how do these things, how do the tendons adapt? You heard very nicely from Peter's talk that although we know a lot about that that humans do adapt to load. We don't really understand exactly what's going on. When we take a look at what this means for performance, of course, you know, these things are interesting for rehabilitation and sports medicine. They're also relevant for performance. And there's, of course, you know, if you want to know whether any kind of musculoskeletal tissue is important for sports, you go to Pear's lab, or you just search for Pear and you find it in his literature. And it's clear that that tendon is the muscle tendon unit is really optimized for mechanical efficiency and transferring efficiently the loads from the tendon to from the muscle to the ground, and the physical basis for this, the physics basis for this, is already well established for 30, 40 years. So it's clear that if you want to have effective power transfer from the muscle to whatever the muscle is trying to move, the tendon stiffness can play an important role there. And more precisely, the more stiff the tendon is, the more effective the power transfer will be. This, of course, there's another side to that coin in the sense that the tendon needs to be compliant and also should have some reserve damage capacity. And so the stiffer the tendon is, the more prone to injury it might be. So there's a balance there. So we know that tendons adapt, but we don't really know much about how they adapt. We don't know the role of the mechanical forces. We know if we unload them, we saw nicely from Peter's talk that they start to lose their mechanical performance. The morphology doesn't appear to change, but the mechanics go down. Conversely, when you train them under heavy load, for instance, they hypertrophy, but the mechanisms for exactly how that works are not exactly known. And of course, when we start to look at disease and tendinopathy, it's a very complex disease, and then the role of mechanics there, although it's heavily implicated in terms of overuse, we also don't know very much there. So I'm going to talk today around this kind of framework that you see here in this slide on the left. You know, what brings a tissue, and when I say the tissue, I mean the tendon, out of quiescence? What makes it stay in a homeostatic steady state? And then can overloading of the tendon push it out of this steady state? And then what happens? And I'll talk a little bit about different contexts for this. But as a baseline, what does tissue quiescence mean? Well, we assume that the tendon has already adapted. We know that the tissue must be receiving something like forces within a physiological range, not too much, not too little. We presume that these forces move through the tissue and are deforming the tissue itself, the matrix, the extracellular matrix of the tissue in a way, and is providing a stimulus to the cells, and that the cells perceive this as being normal and therefore do not react heavily to it. And then the tissue kind of maintains this steady state. So we know that from Peter's lab and other people's work, we know that there's a kind of a low level turnover of the tissue in the background, and we can debate this maybe when we come to the discussion part of the talk. However, we know that when we train, if we push ourselves, if we increase the amount of loads outside of our comfort zone, and we push the tissues of our body to adapt, that they do adapt, and this happens in the tendon. So we presume that the forces go to a point where the tissues perceive that they need to adapt. And there's a reinforcement of the tendon, and you can see that I mentioned here in the slide that the core reinforcement. So there's overload detection by the cells in the tissue, and then they reinforce the core of the tissue. So what does core reinforcement mean? So we have physiological forces; they're still in the physiological range. They provoke the tissue out of homeostasis, and then either there's collagen synthesis going on, could be around the periphery of the tendon, or it could be in the core. This is to discuss maybe later. And then Peter nicely introduced this idea of collagen cross-linking at the molecular level. Maybe the tendon tissue is becoming stiffer. On the other side, whenever we have in the context of injury or tear or chronic damage or overuse, we have kind of a more of a wound healing response. Where the organ becomes activated and then the vascular parts of the tissue become activated. You may have nerve tissue ingrowth, and Peter showed this slide as well. It's a nice pictorial view of this. Basically, the tissue moves from a quiescent state where it's mostly type 1 collagen, which doesn't have much vascularity or nerve ingrowth, and then the tissue is provoked into an adaptation that looks something like wound healing. And of course, when we take a look at the, you know, in the orthopedic hospital where I work, rotator cuff repair, if you have a tear of the tendon, this is kind of the end stage of the disease, early stage of the of tendon disease, might look like overuse, you know, tendonitis, inflammation is now fairly clearly implicated in tendon disease, and that's interesting. Or you can have pathological loading in terms of impingement that shouldn't be there. But of course, as soon as you start to have localized matrix breakdown, the cells that are in the tissue here, if you punch a hole in the middle of a tissue, the tissue that's on either side of that hole, this tissue becomes unloaded and the tissue that's intact starts to become fairly heavily loaded. So when we, I'm going to focus a lot on this overload detection, and I'm mostly going to talk about it in the coming slides in terms of reinforcement of the core. And the key questions I want to talk about today are, what are the cells that monitor the tissue? So what are the cells that are trying to look for the forces in the tissue? What does tissue overload mean in this context? I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the cellular and molecular mechanisms that cells use to sense these forces. I'm going to talk a little bit about what the biology downstream of this sensation is. And I want to talk about some human things about what the relevance of this work might be, or this information might be. So the first one, which cells monitor the tissue loads? So if we take a look inside the classic view, you have the peritendinous region here, and inside the tendon core, you have the collagen fibers, fibrils, which were introduced by Peter nicely. These are kind of bundled into collagen fibers. And if we look at a slightly more macroscopic view, you can see these collagen fibers very nicely lined up. And this is what a fiber might look like in an electron micrograph. And then if you look with a fluorescence image, you can see that you have these cells that are in the mid-substance of the tendon, nicely aligned with the collagen fibers of the tissue. And here you can see a tendinocyte, I'll call it. But basically you have a tissue that's buried deep inside a cell that's buried deep inside the tissue. And you can see this cell here it appears to be maybe synthesizing a collagen fiber. So this is actually maybe doing something anabolic inside the tissue. Hard to say, but what's clear is that this cell is in very close communication with the collagen fiber that it's attached to. Okay, so this already gives us a hint that these tendon cells, which are buried inside the tendon, are positioned in a very unique position to feel the forces inside the tissue. So when I was a postdoc, now almost 15 years ago, I was doing in vivo imaging, delivering a focal confocal fibered confocal microscope tip to the tendon of mice and rats, and then stretching the tendons to see what would happen. And this is a typical movie that slightly sped up. But what you can see here is, as I'm dorsiflexing the foot of the mouse, you can see that the tendon is moving quite pronounced, in a very pronounced way. If we take a little deeper look inside the tissue and we analyze what's exactly going on inside the tissue, though, we see that most of these tissue movements are sliding movements. The actual cells that are buried inside the tissue actually don't get deformed very much. So we can do a little bit of an engineering analysis here, and we see that most of the deformations in the tissue are taken up by sliding of the collagen fibers, but the collagen fibers and the cells that are attached to them actually don't stretch very much, so usually around 2%. So really, when we dorsiflex the foot like crazy, the tissue stretches in a passive way and the cells don't receive that much stimulus. So which cells monitor the tissue loads? Well, tendinocytes on the collagen fibers are a good candidate. And, you know, if you take a much, much more is known about bone mechanobiology, it's probably the most studied musculoskeletal tissue in terms of mechanical response. And it's clear now, after a lot of work, that the osteocytes tend to be these cells that are otherwise quiescent, buried deep inside the bone tissue. However, they're very active. They have a very active physiological role, and that role is to monitor mechanical loads. And I suspect that there's an analogy to the tendinocyte, which is also fairly buried in a dense extracellular matrix in terms of its sensory capacity. We can maybe come back to this later too. So what is tissue overload? What does that actually mean? All right. So if we take a look at the kind of a composite tendon load deformation stress curve, all right. So this is kind of just made up by me. with ranges. But if we know that maximum physiological muscle stresses or muscle activation stresses the tendon to about 30 to 40 megapascal, okay, or newton per square, so 30 newtons per square millimeter of tissue is a megapascal. We can see that, you know, we can kind of get this is somehow the physiological range of tendon loading. Tendon, of course, has an overload capacity, and then the tendon will start to, in an in vitro experiment, will start to tear until it eventually fails. Okay, so if we just think about what logically is going on in the tissue, we can already kind of hypothesize about a few overload limits. So for instance, between A and C, we could say that might be daily use, mechanical loads on the tissue that would accord with daily use, and that the stretch in the tissue might be in the range of less than 5%. And then we have kind of an overload capacity here where the tissue is not really starting to damage, or maybe it starts to damage. And this is where we would expect, exactly in this low region here, we would expect if you were going to have tendon adaptation, that the cells, if they feel daily forces to start to cross into this zone here, this is where you would logically expect them to start to adapt the tissue to make it more robust. And of course, then if you really exceed the loading capacity of the tissue, you start to get into a damage response. So this is also during my postdoc, once I had the methods kind of under control a little bit, it took a few years. If you're in the middle of your own postdoc, don't give up hope. What seems like a total waste of your time might actually end up working out. Might take you 10 years to sort through your data, but still. But basically what you see here is an Achilles tendon of a mouse, and we've cut a small part of the Achilles tendon away, the medial part of the gastroc, for instance. And what you can see is that we don't really affect the low region of tendon response here. However, we've definitely damaged the tendon, which you can see in the load to failure. So what happens here when we cut this tendon is all the mechanics that would normally go through this section, mechanical forces that would normally go through this section of the tissue, get transferred over to the other sections of the tissue. So these mechanical loads are shunted from here over to the intact part of the tissue. And when we take a look using the microscope here, to what's going on in the Achilles tendon of these mice that have had this injury put in place, when I stretch the intact tendon, you can see that the cells that are inside the tissue are really only being stretched to this 2% level that I mentioned earlier. But as soon as we damage part of the tissue and the loads get shunted over to the rest of the tissue, the intact part of the tissue, the tissue loads really go up. So it's a passive flexion of the foot, and the tendon is being stretched. And the cells that are buried in the intact part of the tendon really receive an increased mechanical stimulus. All right. So, then, you know, I was working with these kind of uncontrollable in vivo experiments for a long time. And then once I got my own faculty position, I decided to do some things that were slightly more controllable, where we started to look under, instead of bringing the microscope to the mouse, we bring the mouse to the microscope, putting little pieces of tissue on an imaging station. And what you can see here is we have a little robotic micromanipulator where we're poking on the tendon. And then we started to play around with calcium imaging as a readout for whether the cells are feeling what we're doing to them. So I'm going to talk a little bit, I'm going to talk a lot in the remaining slides about stretch activated ion channels. And what you see here is that when we're poking on this tissue here, we're opening up ion channels that let calcium into the cell. And then we use a calcium reporter that allows you to visualize the cell. So when we take this kind of abstracted poking experiment and we bring a tissue onto the cell, and here you see a little stretching apparatus which is attached to the microscope. It took us a long time to figure out how to get these images to work, mostly in terms of really you have to really preserve a physiological environment on the tendon. Otherwise, all of these responses that you're going to see here in a minute just disappear. And what you see is we're just letting this tissue in the top just float on the microscope. It's not really being stretched. You see a few flashes of cells in different places. And this is kind of spontaneous calcium activity in the tissue. As soon as we, however, start to stretch the tissue, you can see that clearly when we stretch the tissue that the cells are starting to respond. So we know that something is making calcium rush into the cells. So the calcium reporter only works on the inside of the cell, and it only works in the presence of free calcium. So we know that there's calcium inside the cells, but we don't know what that calcium is doing or how it got in, really. So it could be that we tore the cell and then the calcium rushed in against its gradient. So there could be damage, or it could be anything, really. So when we do some experiments where we see, you know, this is the background calcium flux here. You can see these are calcium events just over about 15 minutes. So 1,000 seconds is about 16 minutes. And we're just counting the number of calcium events that we have. And then when we stretch the tissue, we can also count the calcium events that we have. And the black ones are the first time that the cell lights up. And the blue ones are the second or third or fourth time that the cell lights up. So you can see that these cells are being stretched so slowly that they flash once, and then they kind of recover, and then they flash again. And then as we stretch the tissue faster, okay, the cells really only flash once and then don't really have time to recover as we continue to stretch them. So here you see on the top, you see the tissue strain. On the bottom, you have the time, the calcium events. And then basically what we're trying to do is we're trying to figure out how much we have to stretch the tissue to get the cells to respond. And this is exactly how we analyze the data. So we try to find the point where 50% of the cells respond, and we see that we're stretching the tissue about 2% before the calcium rushes in. If we stretch the tissue a little bit faster, you see it's around 3%, and if we stretch it really at, well, you know, human physiological speeds, I don't know if that's what's physiological for a mouse running, but 3.74%. Okay, but what's interesting, if we look at on this device I show, we can also measure the mechanics of the tissue. You can see that the tissue kind of deforms elastically and then starts to creep. And then here it deforms elastically and then starts to creep. And here it's elastically and then starts to creep. And you can see that these thresholds, oh yeah, I'll come back to that in a second, but well, let me go to the end here. So these thresholds for the creeping probably correspond to the onset of viscoelastic mechanism. So what you can imagine is the tissue is being stretched and it's elastic, and then suddenly you start to get something like sliding amongst the collagen fibers, and then this correlates to where we see the calcium happening. In terms of the 2% to 4%, this accords pretty nicely with what we suspected would be the upper physiological range of the tissue. So these calcium fluxes, these calcium flashes kind of seem to occur at the place where we would expect the tissue would adapt if we were stretching them. And then also you can see that in the healthy tissue in vivo, most tissues are never going above these thresholds where we see the calcium activity. So we started to kind of get suspicious that these calcium signals might represent a visualizable response to overload. So what is tissue overload? Possibly it could be mechanical forces that exceed more than 2% of the core tissue stretch, and it could relate to the onset of damage. So how do the cells sense this overload? Well, we take a look at what's going on inside the tissue here. Okay, so we stretch the tissue kind of from far away, and the cells that are buried inside this dense core here are attached to their collagen fibers. And, you know, there's stretch of the collagen fiber that they're on. These collagen fibers are what you see here in this little picture here. This is after we've stretched the tissue 3%. And before we took this image that you see here, we photo bleached very straight lines into the tissue. And what we can see is that we can then decompose the tissue deformation when we apply 3% stretch. You can see that the tissue is actually, at the cell level, the tissue is only stretching about 2%. Okay, the rest of the tissue deformation is being taken up in sliding of the collagen fibers. Okay, and the sliding of the collagen fibers, you can see, because these formerly straight lines become quite wavy. And this is just reflecting the fact that the tissue on the inside is sliding. Okay, so the cells that are positioned between these collagen fibers, they're both being stretched and they're also being sheared. And they're also being squeezed. So these two collagen fibers, also as the tissue gets elongated, are going to squeeze this cell kind of in between. So there's different places that these forces could be going into the cell. So we built a little experimental setup where we create these kind of rubber channels where we can seed tendon cells. And you can see these tendon cells attach very well to the bottom of these channels. And they form nice networks to each other, so they're in communication with each other. And then we can bring them to different kind of abstract loading setups. And what you see here is this is a fluid chamber where we can really just give them sliding. We give them fluid flow over the top of them, and that just gives them a sliding stimulus only. Okay. And then if we bring them into, if we bring them onto the rubber and we don't give them the ability to make a matrix, so if we don't give them ascorbic acid or vitamin C, they don't form a matrix on top of them, and then they only have this physical attachment to the rubber. There's no extracellular matrix around these cells and no pericellular matrix around these cells. And what we find is that when we bring them to the fluid chamber, they're extremely sensitive to fluid flow. So we have to put very little fluid flow over them, and then we get these calcium responses. And as far as we could tell, this is non-damaging to the cell. So the cells respond to it biologically. There's all kinds of things that get re-regulated in the cell downstream of this. But the cells survive quite well. If we bring them to the stretch setup, we get something very different. So we really have to stretch the hell out of the cells to get them to light. And what we find is that that really we don't see calcium entering the cells until we really have damaged the cells. So the calcium does show up here in the stretch experiment, but really at high levels of stretch. And the cells will then die shortly after this experiment. So this is, it points in the direction that shear is coming into focus a little bit for what the cells are actually looking for. And of course, as I mentioned, you know, the cells are buried inside the matrix. And then as you have this sliding inside the matrix, if you do a little bit of mathematical modeling, you see that that really this 5 Pascal of shear force, of shear stress that we give to the cells seems to be fairly reasonable in terms of physiological level. And then, you know, this is what you see, a typical picture where we have no flow, and then a static picture, and then we put the flow over, and then we can verify that the cells are responding. And this is what a typical shear flow dose response curve looks like. And you can see that really 5 Pascals of shear is activating most of the cells in the experiment. Okay. And then the question is, what's this underlying mechanism? So there's all kinds of potentially mechanosensitive ion channels in the membrane of the cell. So there's maybe at least 20 known ones. So we had a look at which are the most known mechanosensitive channels in a cell. And these are typical channels that you see. You can see these are very complex proteins that form very complex mechanical structures. So really they're switches, they're mechanical switches. And they're embedded in the membrane. And when the membrane stretches, these switches open up. So we had a look. These are a list of the most common ones in mouse and a corresponding list of the most common ones in human, at least the most common ones that are known. And then we systematically started to knock them out using CRISPR. So you might have heard of this technique of CRISPR-Cas9 gene editing. You can do in cells, you can do fairly effective knockouts. So what you can see here is a typical knockout where we knocked out one of these channels, PA2-1, and you can see that we knock out most of the channels, but you can see some channels are still showing up. So the knockouts are never really perfect. And that's just the way biology is. So you try to get rid of something, but you have a really hard time to keep biology down. So, but nonetheless, you can see what we see is when we knocked out all of these channels that we suspected to play a role, one of the channels is really turning out to be quite sensitive. And it's this channel PA2-1. And you can see a little movie here, a typical response where you can see how the cells that have the channel on the left, no target, and the cells that have been knocked out on the right with the knockout, and you can see that we really get rid of the calcium signaling. And the channel has this nice, beautiful structure where the channel is mechanically activated, and then this little switch opens up whenever you stretch the membrane. Okay. Good. All right. So how do cells sense overloading? One possible answer is that they use stretch-activated ion channels, and PA2-1 seems to be a good candidate for this. Okay. So how do the cells respond to the overload? Well, there. Luckily, PA2-1 was discovered about 10 years ago, and there's been some pharmacological drug development against it as a target, and there's a fairly specific small molecule that you can use to stimulate this, and it's called iota. And here's what the movie looks like when you put iota on a tendon fascicle that you take out of a mouse. The cells just go bananas. And so we can take a rat tail fascicle and bring it into an incubator that allows us to keep the tissue under kind of a low level static tension. And then every 3 days we stimulate these cells for 30 seconds with this drug. So we kind of pharmacologically open the channel or exercise the channel using this drug. And then what we see when we see how the tissue adapts is that within 2 weeks, we can see that we start to get small changes in stiffness of the fascicles. So we do, in fact, start to get something that looks like an anabolic response in as little as 2 weeks. So with 3% stiffness increase, the diameter of the tissue stays the same, but the mechanical properties start to come up, right? Which is already interesting. Okay. Now, there's also the nice thing about this channel being known for a while and it's starting to gain some traction in terms of it's turning up to be important in many tissues. There's a nice mouse model that was used, which has a so-called gain of function, piezo-1. And this is what you see as a typical stimulation applied to the channel. And here you can see the calcium response of the channel and the normal functioning channel. What you have is you have these genetic mutations in the channel, which makes the channel kind of slow to close. So there's small point mutations in the protein structure, which make the channel not exactly line up. And when the channel is opened and then it goes to close, it's kind of slower to close than the normal channel. So what this means is you hit it and then some calcium comes into the wild type. And then in the mutated channel, it's open and then more calcium comes in than would otherwise be normal. And this is what's called a gain of function mutation. And when we take a look at, we were given some mice that have this gain of function mutation, and we just did some simple biomechanical testing on their tendons. And in fact, what we saw is that in the mice that have this gain of function mutation, they clearly have stronger tendons, stiffer and stronger tendons. So they're stiffer by about 25%, and they're about 15% stronger. So that with more energy to failure. What's interesting is their diameters are even, okay, they're, let's say they're the same, okay? So there's very little difference in the diameters of the tissue. The length of the tendon is the same. The diameter of the tendon is the same. By eye, they look exactly the same. It's just the ones that have this slow closing ion channel are stiffer. Okay, and we take a look, really, we use some electron microscopy to look a little bit deeper into the tendon. We see that there's no obvious difference in the collagen structures. And this would point to functional adaptation by collagen cross-linking. Okay, so because the tendons have the same cross-sectional area, on the ultrastructural level, the amount of collagen and the size of the collagens, the collagen assembly looks similar. The one thing that we can't see here is the cross-linking of the tendon, and that's the most, to our mind, the most obvious way to explain it. Okay, so how do cells respond to overloading? Perhaps the activation of the piezo-1 channel leads to tendon stiffening, and our data is pointing to collagen cross-linking. All right, so what's the relevance and the impact? What does this mean for human? What does this mean for us? Okay, well, interestingly, this piezo-1 gain of function was described in this paper by Ma and Cell in 2018. And they describe it as this protein, this leaky ion channel, confers a resistance to endothelial cells, red blood cells against malarial infection. Okay, so it alters the mechanical response of a red blood cell, and it makes it less likely for a malaria parasite to come in. And what this means is that you end up with a selection pressure in malarial-heavy countries. Right? So people who have a leaky ion channel in their genetic makeup, if it's non-lethal and it helps you survive, it ends up in your population. And about one third of the African population, overall African population, carries this piezo-1 gain of function that's conferred by a deletion at E756. All right. If you take a look at the European populations, you can see that Caucasian people don't have this mutation. There's an interesting paper that was published in 2012 by my colleague Peter. I think it's the only paper I could find that I know of looked at certainly African American people of African American descent versus people of Caucasian descent, and they reported a small difference in mechanical properties. Of course, these kinds of experiments are very difficult, and there's a lot of variation in the population too. And only about one third of Africans, people of African descent should have this mutation anyway. But still, this is interesting. And of course, you know, everyone's anecdotal experience is that when you look at a typical 100 meter final in the Olympics, usually all eight contestants are of West African descent. In fact, in the last eight Olympics, all 64 finalists we had were of West African descent. Okay, now there's many, many things, of course, that go into performance, muscle mass and anatomy and many, many other things. But still, it's tantalizing to think for us anyway, in our thinking that maybe the tendon is playing a role in this functional performance. 70% of NBA players are African-American, although African-Americans make up 13% of the population. And so our question naturally was, does PTO1 confer a tendon performance advantage? So we did, I don't know if anybody from the Silbernagel group is in the audience, I hope so. I met Karen a couple years ago, and she's an extremely dynamic individual. And we were able to get this study on legs extremely fast. And her team that she's working with, this is a Swiss PhD student sitting amongst all the people that helped them with the study. But we did a genotyping study on 65 subjects, African-American, with no history of Achilles tendon. And we investigated their genotype. So it was a double-blind study. So we collected saliva swabs and genotyped them. We did standard tendon morphology testing and functional testing that's done in Karen's lab all the time. And just a quick word about the functional testing we did. So the functional test that I'm gonna focus on today, we were specific. We knew we were going to have a huge amount of variation in the data, just because of, you know, men, women, body type, training history, diet, everything. And what we hoped, beyond all hope, was that we hoped that if we somehow normalized a drop counter movement jump to a counter movement jump, that we might be able to isolate something that should be uniquely attributable to the tendon elastic properties. So in other words, the ability of the tendon to store and then release mechanical energy after it's been loaded. And this is the outcome measure that I'll present today. So the hypothesis was, on the one hand, when we genotype the patients, we would identify those carrying this gain of function mutation, and then two, hopefully see an improved energy return in these carriers. So we can see that here you can see the percentage of male and females in the group: 15 not carrying the gain of function, 9 carrying it, 28 females not carrying it, 13 carrying it. So perhaps slightly overrepresented in these populations, but nothing surprising there. No real differences between the groups, carriers and non-carriers, in terms of age, height, or weight. No real difference in history of, let's say, the highest level of sports participation. Didn't really matter whether they had the, maybe you could say they were trending towards something here in terms of people who played sports in secondary school, but nothing emerging here in terms of the overall activity. Let's say sports participation history, the level of competitiveness or the activity level. No difference in tendon morphology in carriers and non-carriers. So same cross-sectional area, median cross-sectional area, no differences in the lengths of the tendon, no obvious differences in morphology. And then we did the testing here. And what we see is that when we looked at the counter movement jump to the drop counter movement jump, we did see no significant difference in the non-carriers, and we did see a significant difference in the carriers. Okay, and then when we normalize one to the other, it's interesting. So we can see that when we take a look at just the normalization of the jumping height, on the one hand, from the counter movement to the drop counter movement, you can see that you have about a 15% difference in the drop counter movement jump on those that have the gain of function. And that would be in line with what we had expected. And when you normalize this height difference to the body mass, of the individual, you can see that this turns into an energetic difference of about a kilojoule, 1 kilojoule. So yes, there seems to be a higher return of stored tendon elastic energy in the people carrying this mutation. So I can see I'm going over time, but nonetheless, I'm finishing up here. So so we conclude the piezo 1 is a tendon shear sensor that regulates tissue stiffness and strength, and that it's likely, or it appears at least in our data, to have a relevant effect on human performance. And what's the impact of this knowledge? Well, the actual impact, of course, these are very fresh results, so we haven't had time to look really into anything yet. But I guess there's impact, potentially implications for performance, therapeutics, and disease mechanisms. So with regard to performance, tissue shear stress is a training target. We heard a little bit about, you know, maybe eccentric loading, maybe not, maybe magnitude, maybe not. But if what it takes is to get the tissues to slide, to stimulate the tissues, it would be interesting to design exercise interventions that specifically elicit kind of a viscoelastic loading of the cells. And there should be, we have a study that's looking at this, and I hope other people will too. Of course, on the therapy side, piezo-1 seems to be a very potent mechano transducer, and it is druggable. It is targetable through biomaterial design, and it may be targetable through physiotherapy. On the aging side, and these will be the last slides that I mentioned, the sliding mechanism provides a plausible explanation for at least some age-related loss of exercise response. And what do I mean by that? So again, we come back to the microscope experiments where we analyze the amount of stretch in the tissue and the amount of sliding in the tissue. And what you can see is that when we age a tissue by culturing it in sugar, we get kind of these age-related, we get a formation of age-related crosslinks in the tendon. So these occur in diabetics and as we naturally age, and this is actually one of our major research topics in my lab. But what you can see here is that almost all of the stretch that we give to the tissue, we give these we stretch these tissues 6%, and almost all of it goes into the aged tissue, into stretching of the tissue. And almost none of it is going into sliding of the tissue. You can see that these lines in the tissue stay very straight. So in a aged or heavily cross-linked tissue, the sliding mechanism that we suspect to be so important for mechanotransduction kind of disappears. And in fact, when we then take a look at the tendons of mice, and we bring them, we have young mice, or let's say adult mice, but young adult mice and very old mice, and we bring them to the microscope, you can see that the baseline 3-month mice, 24-month mice, when we stretch the younger adult mice, they light up nicely. And when we stretch the young mice, the older mice, they just don't light up. So they light up a little bit, but this again points to an age-related loss of mechanically driven calcium signaling. All right, so that is my talk. So Peter had a nice comment that anything that's not been peer-reviewed, you should take with a grain of salt. So you will all have to go home and eat a huge amount of salt after this talk, because it's in revision. Not the same as being accepted, unfortunately, but these are all the people that contributed to this really with what's turned out to be a huge amount of work. And Fabian Pacini is the mastermind behind most of this work. A lot of help from Karen Silbernagel. Patrick Yeager is also a major contributor, and so is Ayman Saab. And that's it. So thank you very much. I'm looking forward to the discussion.
Thank you. Yes, thank you for a very nice presentation and enlightening tour into the microdynamics and nanoscales of tendon tissue. I think we have 10-15 minutes for discussion and questions. And I don't know. I have noted down a large number of questions for the both of you, so we could keep on for all night. So maybe just courtesy to Jørn, my co-chairs, Jørn Hilje and Jan Kabri, maybe you would like to start with a few questions.
No, Pierre, please, you go ahead.
Okay, so yeah, I hoped you would say something like that, Jørn. Anyways. I have a question for both of you, actually. I think looking at the data from YES, I'm kind of suggesting that the shear stress is maybe the main stimulant on tenocytes or on cells for creating signaling or sensing of forces. Then all of a sudden I understand why the findings from Peter's lab of these fully extended collagen molecules that goes from one end unbroken basically to the other end, why this is really clever. Because by having this arrangement, I guess that will give you maximum strain between collagen molecules or collagen fascicles. Whereas if we had this broken arrangement, we would not really be able to sense that much of a strain between fascicles or between molecules. So I think that it goes really, really nice hand in hand that shear stress should be the main biological stimulus for anabolic responses in this tissue here. So I don't know if you would like to comment on that, Yes?
I'd be interested to hear whether Peter believes that the shear stress is a good candidate at all.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So we need to back down a step, I guess. So Peter?
Well, I think that we've had some similar thoughts along those lines, and certainly it seems to make sense. My question becomes, when is too much shear a bad thing, and why is it that individuals that perform the same activity with the same body weight load, why do they get injured? And the latter part kind of alludes to maybe, well, what's the relative contribution to compression, even though I realized you had some nice data for the shear based on fluid flow. Is there a recovery period as it relates to shear in individuals? I mean, you know, we see on a human level that collagen synthesis is increased, again, take it with a grain of salt, after 24, 48 hours. So I've always wondered what happens if you do the same great load after, let's say, 24 hours. Yeah, those were lots of questions at the same time, sorry.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that there's a lot of questions, but I think it's, what is the injury, you know? I think that even it's not still not clear exactly what repetitive loading does to the tissue and what injury even means. And from my you know much more about it than I, but I still somehow the complexity of overuse injury, both biological complexity and also just physical complexity, is daunting. I think in terms of the shear as a mechanism, I think for let's say an overload sense, I agree with Per's original question. I think that, you know, it's smart to position a sensor to be sensitive to exactly the part of the tissue where things start to move in a way that's not normal. And you do your normal daily stuff, and the cells are of course getting slightly abused, but then whenever you really abuse them, they notice it. Mm-hmm. And I guess I don't know whether the PSO1 or let's say this shear, particular shear sensor, it makes sense that you have a kind of a very specific sensor in a very specific part of your loading curve that's responsible for a very specific response. And you know, if you knock this channel out in a very young mouse, the tendon develops just fine. And so that you it really seems to be a sensor for the adult fully mature tendon. And I think it's also elegant maybe if the sensor also kind of switches on collagen cross-linking. It's kind of an elegant way to augment the tissue without really precipitating a huge biological response like vascular ingrowth or otherwise. Yeah, I don't know.
I guess there must be a time factor that plays a role here, because most individuals that get these overuse injuries, they perform basically the same thing, but maybe they'll do it more often or for a longer period of time. Or, I mean, certainly people can get it if they try something new, so they load the tendon differently and or more. But a lot of people, they will perform the physical activity going from, let's say, 3 days a week to 5 days a week, and it's running, so the forces going through the tendon is the same, and presumably the shear forces.
Yeah, I mean, like, I guess there's the passive damage that happens in the matrix too, right? So I guess it's, you know, every time you load a collagen structure, it takes on some damage, it moves, and you can call it an accumulating damage. And the damage has to be given enough time to reverse itself, either reverse itself, physically reverse itself, or actively by cell mechanisms repair itself. And I guess, I don't know how you feel about it, but I view kind of these overuse injuries as matrix injuries, where the ability of either the tissue to kind of passively recover or actively recover is just not keeping up with the amount of damage that's being pumped into the matrix by use. I don't know if you have
I think the short answer is that nobody knows, but that what you're suggesting, I think, is certainly plausible, and that's how most people, I think, also view this injury. But the other aspect of it is, of course, just the cellular response in terms of other proteins that are being produced when it's too much shear. So you get proteoglycans, glycosaminoglycans, they attract water, the tendon swells, you get pain from the swelling. So there's maybe a somewhat overlooked aspect of the cellular component and what that does, as opposed to the tensile bearing component, which can also be a part of it. One doesn't exclude the other.
May I ask? I'm sorry, Per. I don't want to
dominate. No. Please go ahead.
Yeah, I wanted to ask Peter about the bomb pulse data in this context. You know,
yeah.
I mean, these data are amazing, and they really kind of changed the field, or at least changed the thinking of a lot of people in the field, or shaped the thinking of a lot of people in the field, or made some people skeptical. I wanted to ask you, like, in view of the very little tissue turnover that we see, what does that imply for you in terms of this kind of passive repair that doesn't require cells versus active repair that would require cells? Because it doesn't look like much is happening in the tendon, in a normal tendon, when you look at your data.
Right. So, and well, it has shaped my thinking into a little bit what I just said previously, namely that one thing is the collagen aspect of these injuries. And it may be that there's still a little bit of maintenance / repair that goes on, but it's only a few percentage points of the total tensile bearing component. But I mean, it's quite obvious that tendons become quite large and painful. And you've just spoken very nicely to the fact that there is shear on the tendon. So something goes on with, I'm sorry, shear on part of the cell. So something goes on with the cell, and we know it has a lot of other proteins that attract water. So I just think that there's been a lot of focus on the collagen part for a good reason. I think that there is an overlooked part of the tendon injury. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know either. I hope so.
I have a question. Probably we need to shut down in 3 or 4 minutes, maybe 5 minutes from now, but there's still some time. I have a short question for you, Peter.
Mm-hmm.
In your presentation, very nicely, you demonstrated that, you know, it shouldn't really make a difference whether eccentric muscle contractions or concentric muscle contractions were employed during the exercise or rehabilitation of tendon injury, because the tendons wouldn't really mind. It's just a matter of the magnitude of force. which I think is a very important point, because it makes a lot of sense for the use of heavy, slow, resistant training regimes in the rehabilitation there. And you showed data from Jean Farup and Christian Wiesing from Aarhus University, nicely demonstrating that in healthy tendons, the adaptive change increase in size was much, didn't differ between eccentric and concentric, but you had these black, these black bars also that were markedly higher than the open bars, and I know, I know that these black bars were actually the individuals who received protein supplementation during training.
Yes,
they had like a 50% greater at increase in cross-sectional area of the tendon. So, so what are your, what are your thoughts on the involvement of stimulation by means of protein supplementation or amino acid intake? What is the role here?
That's a great question, and that's correct, that it looks like based on that data, and there aren't that many studies on this topic, that maybe amino acid supplementation may also play a role in terms of the hypertrophy. It's a field that, that people are very interested in now, in particular as it relates to injuries. But we have to wait and see, I think. But it looks like it could be very interesting,
Yeah, so do you have any plans, maybe you don't want to tell us, but any plans for combining the intake of amino acids with the with the rehabilitation regimes that you're using?
We have ongoing studies of that. But that would be showing you any preliminary data on that means that you would have to like take it with a bucket of salt. So I,
of course, but it's nice to know that the experiments are on their way, because it looks really promising. And then later on, we need to figure out the mechanisms that, that, that goes into play.
Yeah.
I also I have a question for you. It's really exciting about this PiezO1 channel, this stretch activated ion channels that you talk about, and you see a huge difference there between those who are high in, I guess, in this or in the genetic variant of this channel, in terms of isolated stiffness on fibrils, I guess. But you have this human experiments going on now, where you could see this difference between drop jumping and, I guess, counter movement jumping, right? Yeah. And you saw that the guys that were high in this mutation, they were having a higher rebound height of the drop jump compared to the counter movement jump compared to controls, right?
Correct.
You call this energy return or energy storage, or?
So
I guess we are kind of imagining that that these tendons would, you know, rich in these collagen fibers would be better in preserving and or releasing energy. But I was thinking that maybe they are just stiffer, and, you know, a stiffer tendon will actually not store as much energy as a more compliant tendon at a given force level. But they are, on the other hand, able to transmit force and power much more efficiently. So it might be a power or rate of force development outcome with the PiezO high genetic variant rather than an passive elastic storage issue.
Yeah, unfortunately, we didn't measure the ground reaction forces. It would have been that would have been the right thing to do. And
The takeoff time or the power generated. And all, even the rate of force development during the takeoff phase of the ground reaction force.
Yeah, so
it would be nice, because we are always thinking about the collagen tissues as these going into the tendons, but, you know, we have much more collagen, I guess, inside the muscle tissue, transmitting forces from one fiber to the other laterally. So we have maybe enormous advantages of having, you know, stiff, kind of stiff collagen tissue in that transversal force transmission too. And I would imagine that would really affect, you know, active force generation quite positively.
Yeah, we what we can say is that in the blinded fashion, we know that those that carry the mutation are more performant in that particular exercise. But where exactly it comes from, we have some work to do.
It would be really nice to do some isolated rate of force development experiments. You know, much more simple on the isolated muscle tissue, where you go to look more at the so-called contractile properties, but you know they are affected by collagen tissue, I guess. I think inside the muscle too.
Yeah, now that, I mean we still have the patients, we have the permission to bring them back to do some follow-up. So
if you do, I have some suggestions for parameters you should measure. Yeah, definitely. It's very simple, unforced place and during isometric contractions. Yeah.
All right, great. Thanks, Pierre.
No problem. Anyone else having any more questions for each other? Well, if not, I think we're kind of forced to conclude this sessions because we are getting close to three. And it was a pleasure, yes, and Peter, to have you here. And thanks a lot for showing up and sharing your exciting data with me and a lot of other participants at the conference. We appreciate it very much. So with these words, I'd like to conclude the session and wish you all some nice events today and tomorrow at the conference. So thanks for now. Yeah.